Imagine standing at the edge of a lake with a perfect skipping stone in hand. You wind up, throw it, and watch as the stone bounces gracefully across the water. But what if there was a way to guarantee that your rock skips more times than ever before? In this video and our next one, we'll dive into the math and physics behind the perfect rock skip. It's not just about brute force or the shape of the stone. It's mainly about the angles. Mark Rober already has a video out about the science of skipping stones and gives some recommendations, but some of the recommendations lack specificity. Suggesting throwers hold the rock at a certain angle or to throw so the rock impacts the water at a certain angle is easier said than done. We will do some math to come up with some rules of thumb for skipping rocks. We will actually find that it's impossible for some throwers to ever have their rocks hit the water at the ideal angle. So what should they do instead? We've split the analysis into two parts. In this video, we analyze the lift angle of the rock and discuss a useful way to construct and measure angles that's different from degrees or radians. In the next one, we'll analyze the launch angle and the nuances involved when trying to get the rock to hit the water at a 20 degree attack angle. Let's put this math in overdrive and hyper-optimize our rock skipping techniques. There are a few different variables when it comes to skipping rocks. The angle the rock approaches the water, what I would call the impact angle, the angle of the flat surface of the rock that's going to touch the water, what I call the lift angle, the velocity of the rock, and the height of release above the water. The rate it spins is also important, and generally the faster the better. The size and shape of the stone matters too. A flat stone with a little heft is best. If the stone's too light, it's too easily affected by wind and waves. As a thrower, you also need to know the launch angle that will result in the right impact angle, and that launch angle can vary from person to person. Mark Rober has already done a great video on figuring the optimal values that make the ideal rock skipping throw. You can check out his video here if you haven't seen it already. He found similar things to other scientists and summarized four aspects of the throw as advice for the perfect skipping throw. A lift angle of 20 degrees, a rock impact angle of 20 degrees, spin the rock as much as possible, and choose a rock that's flat on the bottom and is as heavy as possible for you to still get to your maximum arm speed. Picking a rock and spinning a rock, items 3 and 4, are both straightforward, but the first two both rely on a 20 degree angle. Let's start with the lift angle. How do you know if you're holding your rock at 20 degrees? You could just estimate the angle by sight, but there is a rule of thumb that might make it easier for you. There's a different way to measure angles that works better here than degrees. There are four common ways to measure angles: degrees, radians, number of revolutions, and the ratio of sides of a right triangle. The last one is more commonly known as slope, and that's the one that we can use to get a better rock skipping throw. Consider estimating an angle of 45 degrees. One easy way to do this is to bisect an angle of 90 degrees. But another way is to adjust until the distance over and the distance up are the same. The ratio of the sides of the right triangle are enough to know the angle and is a natural way to measure the steepness of a line on a graph, as well as angles, in some real life contexts. For example, this strategy is used in construction to talk about the pitch or angle of roofs. They give pitches or angles by two numbers, like a 412 or 812. A 412 pitch means the roof goes up 4 units for every 12 horizontal units. 812, up 8 units for every 12 units horizontal. These correspond to slopes of 1/3 or 2/3 respectively. This is very handy, because if a carpenter needs to make a cut that matches the angle of the roof, then they can measure over and then up on the board to make the marks and connect them with a chalk line. Much easier and more accurate than hauling a large protractor around. Well, what is the pitch of a roof that is 20 degrees? We need a way to connect the pitch or slope to the angle. Mathematicians have already developed a function to do that. It's a trig function called tangent. The tangent function takes in an angle in degrees or radians and gives out the slope of the line at that angle. Inverse tangent, or sometimes called arctangent, takes in a slope as an input and outputs the angle in degrees or radians. Now we can reason what the tangent of 45 degrees is. It will be 1, because the line with slope 1 goes up 1 unit for every unit we move to the right. If we take the tangent of 60 degrees, we get a value of about 1.73. So two lines diverging at 60 degrees will have a ratio of 1.73 units up for every unit over. For our purposes though, we're interested in using the ratio to create an angle. Since 1.73 is approximately 7/4, we could go over 4 units and up 7 to approximate an angle of 60 degrees. Or we could go over 1 unit and up 1.73 units to approximate an angle of 60 degrees. many of you already learned that the tangent of an angle is the ratio of an opposite leg of a right triangle with that angle and the adjacent leg. But many of you may think of tangent as the ratio of sine of an angle and cosine of that angle. These are connected in the unit circle. Given an angle in the unit circle, this right triangle has sides of sine and cosine, and since sine is the opposite side and cosine is the adjacent side, the tangent is the ratio of those two values. But that is also the slope of the hypotenuse of the triangle, since sine is the rise and cosine is the run. But the power of trigonometry comes from the fact that this ratio is the same as any right triangle with that angle. If we extend the hypotenuse of this triangle in the unit circle and extend a line up from the point 10, then we can make another triangle. The ratio of these two sides is this length, divided by the radius of the circle, which is a 1. So the length has to equal sine divided by cosine, but since sine divided by cosine is tangent, this length is also the tangent of this angle. In fact, this is where tangent gets its name. This vertical line is a tangent line to the circle, and the tangent function is the length that is cut off at a given angle. We can use this to actually generate the graph of the tangent function. The tangent of 20 degrees is about 0.364. That means the ratio of these two sides should be 0.364. Well, that's pretty close to the value of 0.33, so if we construct a right triangle with a height of 1 and a length of 3, or legs of length 1 and 3, then the narrow angle is going to be about 20 degrees. We can use this rule of thumb now to help us with our rock skipping. When you angle the front of the rock up, then imagine a right triangle coming down from the front and then over to the back. You want the vertical leg of the triangle to be about 1/3 of the length of the horizontal leg. For many of us, this method might be easier to estimate than just judging an angle of 20 degrees. So we have our first modification to Mark Rober's rules. Create a lift angle of 20 degrees, which you can estimate with a 1:3 right triangle. We took a little extra time to understand the tangent function because that'll help us in our next video as well when we analyze the launch angle and the impact angle. That analysis is more involved and much more technical and much more surprising. Do you have a record for a number of skips that you would like to brag about? Put it in the comments. I read that a skip in a competition is defined as getting off the water by a centimeter, although I don't know how they judge that in competitions. My best was in a lake on Mount Wheeler in Great Basin National Park in Nevada. The lake is surrounded by shale, a rock that naturally breaks into wide flat rocks, so it is perfect for rock skipping. Trying my best to count the skips, I got into the 30s, but it was really hard to tell in the end where it glides more than skips, so I don't know how many would have been counted in an actual competition. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe and share our videos. Be sure to follow Math the World on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Thank you so much for your support.